understanding, turn your Bibles to the book of Hosea. Turn your Bibles to the book of Hosea, chapter 4, verse number 6. Chapter 4, verse number 6. We'll go right into this morning's message because there's a lot that I want to give to you to better you and empower you. While the ministry of music is coming down, just put your hands together one more time and give God some praise. I am excited about what God's going to do for you on today. And I solicit your prayers as I'm going through a metamorphosis of becoming a different guy before your very eyes. And the growing pains can sometimes be difficult because I'm preaching a message not geared toward where we are, but I'm preaching a message designed for where we're going. So there's a difficulty and a tension when you're seeing yourself beyond where you currently are. Hosea chapter 4, verse number 6. While you're standing, the word of God declares, my people are destroyed from a lack of knowledge. We're very familiar with that part of the text because most often the preacher would stop right there and place the blame on you. But the Bible did not actually stop right there in verse 6. There's some more to the message that the preacher have been disclosing from you. It says, my people are destroyed from a lack of knowledge because you have rejected knowledge. I also reject you as my priest. He's talking to the pulpit, not just to those in the congregation. Because you have rejected knowledge, I have also rejected you as my priest. Because you have ignored the law of your God, I will also ignore your children. To take your seats and say, it's time to wake the heaven up. Remember on last week we discussed the fact Jesus declared the truth will set you free. And today we see that God is declaring my people are destroyed from a lack of knowledge. Notice neither Jesus nor God is giving the devil any power to control us and my decisions and my choices on Front Street. I am who I am. I am where I am, not because of the attack of the devil. I am where I am because of the sum total of my collective decisions. And you are wherever you are right now because of the sum total of your decisions. The devil has no power unless you surrender and give the devil power. I want you to understand something this morning. I'm not trying to mess you up. I'm not trying to put you down. I'm not trying to minimize your struggle. But most of your struggle is not based on spiritual warfare. Most of your struggle is based on a lack of knowledge in decision and a lack of knowledge in the choices you're making. So the results you're getting, they're lined up with the choices you're making. Yes. But we want to blame the devil because that's easier to blame the devil. But God says, my people are perishing, being destroyed from a lack of knowledge. Then he places and shifts the spotlight from the people to the priests because the priests are not teaching the people correctly. The people are walking around being defeated because of a lack of knowledge, because somewhere the priest went from being the messenger of God to trying to be God. And when the priest trying to be God, God now steps back and let the priest have control of the people. Now the people are following the priest instead of following God, where it should be. The priest is simply telling you what thus says the Lord. But now the modern day priest is so concerned about entertaining you and getting you vaccinated with them that they've forgotten about the word of God. And I have no power outside of the word of God. I can only say what thus says the Lord. Anything else is my intellect and my intelligence. And I don't care how smart I am or how smart you are, we're still limited in the degree of knowledge that we have. That's why the Bible says, lean not on your own understanding. But we've been bamboozled to shout on Sunday morning with no revelation that can keep us on Monday morning. So the people were perishing, being destroyed destroyed. Statistics alarmed me when I heard this week that the divorce rate in the church is tripled.
My God. Lord. My God.
We should have the power.
Come on, man of God.
All right now.
Yet we are being defeated in record-breaking numbers. There's more sick folks sitting in the pews. There's no distinguishing difference between the people who go to church on a regular basis and the people who go to the club on a consistent basis. Somewhere something is broken. And it's not God nor heaven. I know this may not be popular. I know you want to get your shout on and you want to run around the church three times and claim money coming and houses coming and cars coming. But what good is it to have a car and you don't want to drive home? What good is it to have money in the bank but you sick so much you spending all your money on medication? What good is it to have stuff and the stuff have you because you're tripping to keep the stuff, so you've lost your moral compass to keep stuff to impress folks who still don't like you with your stuff?
Yes, Lord.
It's time we wake the heaven up and regain our God-given power. You see, I was sharing again in the back. We have some very interesting conversations before church in the back. I wish sometime we could just put it on social media and Periscope and just let you hear the conversation and go in the back before I come out. But one of the guys was saying that he had lost his joy this week. I said, no, you didn't lose your joy. You gave it up. I'm not trying to minimize your struggle again, but I'm at a point now in my life where God has shown me he's capable of taking care of me to the point can't nobody get me out of my zone.
Come on!
Now, I may every now and then surrender my peace to you. I may now, every now and then, let you take something from me, but I'm not going to give it up. You take it. Excuse me. You can't take it. I got to give it up. You don't have that kind of power. You can't jack me for nothing. I got to give it up. I got to surrender. I got to temporarily forget how much I know about God. Because whenever I forget about what I know about God, then I'm hoping for you to come in and rob me. But when I think about how good God has been, you can't take nothing from me. There you go, that little arrogant little preacher again. No, I'm not arrogant, but I've read the Bible enough to know the Bible is loaded with winning scriptures. And if the Bible is loaded with winning scriptures, I shouldn't be losing. The reason I'm losing is I'm trying everything else to win except the winning formula, and that's God's word. If we really do what his word says, faith without works is dead. If I really apply the word of God in every area of my life, I'm guaranteed to win in every area of my life.
Thank you, God.
If not, then God's a liar. So you're wondering sometimes, why am I going through all the hell I'm going through? Why am I going through all the difficulties? Because God is trying to prove to you that he can take care of you. God is trying to prove you he can bring you through. So your confidence will go up and your faith in God will increase so God can carry you from victory to victory, from glory to glory. Tuesday, across America, we went to the polls and cast our votes as an expression of our American rights. For me personally, Deacon Carter, voting is very special. Because as a young boy, my grandfather would let me ride to the polls with him to cast his vote. And he would share with me the struggles that black men had to endure to gain the right to vote. And he told me, son, don't ever give up your right to vote. I don't care who you vote for, but make sure you vote because we vote for you to have the right to vote. So I honor my grandfather every year by going to the election poll and casting my vote. But he would tell me, it's no matter who gets elected, I want you to vote, but understand something, that even after you cast your vote, no matter who gets elected, God is still in control.
Yes, he is.
And Jesus is still the answer. See, the problem, too many of us have been depending on other sources other than God is in control. He didn't say God was in control. He didn't say Jesus would be the answer. He said God is in control, and Jesus is the answer. And he had a third grade education, grew up on a sharecropper's plantation in Louisiana, but he had enough sense to realize no matter what, God is the answer. Jesus is the answer. So no matter what you're doing in the earth realm, make sure you stay connected to the heaven realm. Wake the heaven up. Sean Puff Daddy Combs in 2004 rallied young people in the hip-hop community to register to vote in his Vote or Die campaign. And in 2008, that campaign played a major role in getting our first African-American president, Barack Obama, elected into office. I, like many of you, watched black people all over America cry tears of joy over the fact we had elected a black man into the White House. Older African-Americans even declared Dr. King's dream is finally becoming a reality in America. How many of you remember those days, eight years ago, we were shouting, we got a black man in the White House. We are about to be empowered. We are about to be the best we've ever done. We walked around with fists of black power, and we felt so good about being black in America. Well,
Come on.
And don't twist it around. I'm not anti-President Barack Obama. I love my president. But I told you 8 years ago, no matter who's in the White House, if you're not having God in your house, won't nothing change in your house. Today, those tears of joy have reversed back to tears of sorrow. Because it's hard to discover many areas where things have drastically gotten better in the same black communities that put a black man in the White House. You show me a black community that has improved over the last 8 years drastically, and I'll show you an example of an exception.
Right.
Matter of fact, on election day eve in Chicago, 9-year-old Tashawn Lee was lured into an alley and gunned down because of his father's possible gang ties. And if that wasn't drastic enough, the Chicago Police Department had to start a GoFundMe account to raise reward money, because no one is willing to speak up or come forward with information to lead to the arrest of the killer. We better wake the heaven up. Listen to this. We have rejected God's plan, but we are holding on to foolishness in our community. That's this foolish saying that snitches get stitches, end up in ditches with the fishes. You better wake the heaven up. Why don't we hold on to foolishness and reject God's word? Watch this. Turn your Bibles to Mark chapter 3, verse 27. Mark chapter 3, verse 27, the Message Bible. Get this. My assignment is to empower you, not to impress you. I want to make you better so you can do better and be better. There's a generation that's coming behind us that deserves a better America. Mark chapter 3, verse 27 from the Message Bible. Get this. The religious scholars from Jerusalem came down spreading rumors that he being Jesus, that Jesus was working black magic, using devil tricks to impress them with spiritual power. And Jesus confronted their slander with a story. Does it make sense to send a devil to catch a devil? To use Satan to get rid of Satan? a constantly squabbling family disintegrates. If Satan was fighting Satan, there soon wouldn't be any Satan left. Do you think it's possible in broad daylight to enter the house of an awake, able-bodied man and walk off with his possessions unless you tie him up first? Tie him up, though, and you can clean him out. Watch this. The religious leaders were divided over Jesus. Some believe he was the truth, and the truth will set you free, while others spread rumors that Jesus was a fake. We say, oh, that was back then. That was back then. But this is a sad reality today. The church is still greatly divided. We're still fighting over who got it right. Over who has the best church denomination. And guess what? While we're fighting on Sunday morning over who got it right and who's doing it better, the devil is kicking all our butts. I looked up, I was curious, and I looked up all the names of all the Baptist groups in America. Now, I'm going to read you a list of the Baptist groups in America. I'm not talking about the Methodist Church. I'm not talking about the Church of God in Christ. I'm not talking about the Lutherans, the Catholics, the Church of Christ. I'm not even mentioning my Muslim brothers who I love. I'm not talking about any non-Christian faith. I'm just going to give you some names of all the Baptist groups that divide. That's not even just one Baptist group in America. Listen to this, and you're wondering why we're losing. Listen to this. I can't even, time won't allow me to read all of them. Because no matter how much research I did, I could not come up with a definite number of how many faith-based Baptist groups there were in America. That's how long the list was. But this is a partial list that I came up with. And you can get the full list in my weekly article. Alliance of Baptists, American Baptist Association, American Baptist Churches, Association of Reformed Baptist Churches of America, Association of Welcoming and Affirming Baptists, Baptist Bible Fellowship, Baptist General Convention, Baptist Missionary Association of America, Central Baptist Association, Christian Unity Baptist Association, Conservative Baptist Association of America, Continental Baptist Churches, Cooperative Baptist Fellowship, Enterprise Association of Regular Baptists, Free Will Baptist, Full Gospel Baptist, Fundamental Baptist Association, Fundamental Baptist Fellowship of America, General Association of Baptists, General Association of General Baptists, General Association of Regular Baptist Churches, General Association of the Evangelical Baptist Church, General Six Principal Baptist, Independent Baptist of America, Independent Baptist Fellowship International, Independent Baptist Fellowship of North America, Constitutional Missionary Baptist Conference of America, Interstate and Foreign Landmark Missionary Baptist Association, Landmark Baptist, Liberty Baptist, Macedonia World Baptist, Mainstream Baptist, National Association of Free Will Baptist, National Baptist Association of America, National Convention of USA, National Baptist Evangelical Life and Soul Save Assembly of the USA, National Missionary Baptist Convention of America. I'm getting tired. And I'm still not through yet. Primitive Baptist, Reformed Baptist. Listen, they got one called Regular Baptist. And that don't blow you away. Then they got a Separate Baptist, a Seventh-day Baptist, a Southern Baptist. I just go, United Baptist, World Baptist Fellowship, and the list goes on and on and on and on. With all these Baptist religious groups, you would think we are winning. But unfortunately, we're spending more time inside arguing over who got it right than we are winning on the outside. Can you imagine if just those that are associated with the Baptist faith in America would all come together and use our collective power and influence, how much we can impact change in our communities? Do you realize how much collective power we would have if we would stop letting the devil divide us, but if we would come together? Do you realize how much energy and synergy we would have if we would stop arguing over who's right and who's wrong and who's better and just come together, one Lord, one faith, and march the devil out of existence? Can you imagine if all the Baptist people people would come together and choose a candidate. We can put a mayor in every city. We can put a president in the White House. Can you imagine if we came together? You know what breaks my heart today? That's a family who desires to be in church, but they have a little boy who plays Little League football, and the Little League football put a game on a Sunday, and that family had to struggle to come to church or support the kid. I told them, go support the kid, and I'll pray for you. But can you imagine if we put our energy together, we can create our own Little League leagues where they play on Saturdays, not on Sunday? It breaks my heart that mothers have to choose a basketball game or a football game on Sunday when they want to have their children in church, but they don't want their children to feel isolated. We need to create our own leagues, but we got to come together collectively. If collectively we come together, we can change the world over.
Yes,
divided, we are weakened.
Yes.
That's the number one reason why divorce rate is so high. Because if a mother and father keep touching and agreeing, Satan has no power. So he keeps you in a battle to keep you divided. So he can keep performing well.
That's good.
It's time we wake the heaven up. The enemy is so afraid of unity. He keeps drama and mess going. Let me test your Bible knowledge. In the book of Genesis, God told the children of faith not to settle in one place, but to go all over the world just spreading and spreading. But they decided, we're going to get comfortable and settle right here, and we're going to build us a tower. We're going to settle right here in Babylon, and we're going to build a tower to heaven so we can go see what it looks like in heaven. So they made their minds up, we're going to come together collectively and build a tower to go spend some time with God. We're not going to wait for God to come down in the cool of the day like he did with Adam and Eve. We're going to just build us a tower and go up to heaven. And this is what God says about their collective unity. God says, yeah, I gotta do something, because if I don't do something now, if they stay connected, if they stay on one accord, there is nothing on the planet earth they cannot accomplish. What God knew, that if he didn't break up their language, they would do what they are set out to do. And I'm telling you right now, the devil has taken God's philosophy. That's why he's messing with you. That's why he's trying to keep you in an argument with somebody. That's why you're always in turmoil and mess. That's why you're always in drama. That's why reality TV is so special and the ratings are so high, because the devil has sabotaged your mind to be attracted to drama and to mess. That's why when there's a wreck on 45 South, there's traffic on 45 North, because everybody like watching somebody else crash instead of getting out and helping somebody. I saw the news this week at one of the local HISD schools. In front of the school, a bunch of sisters was fighting one another, young and old, and instead of bringing it up, other folks took out their phone and was recording a drama. A young girl even got ran over by a car, and instead of anybody rendering aid, they all was recording their phone, laughing and joking. The devil has messed us up. Stop blaming the white man. There were no white folks on the scene. I know it's real easy to shift all the blame responsibility on the police, the white man, the other man, your baby daddy, your no showing up daddy, your no good mama. It's easy to shift the blame to somebody else, but when you gonna wake the heaven up and realize you are responsible for your own destiny, and you got a word in front of you that you grab hold to, that word, it will work for you. And pastoring a bunch of entitled whiners and complainers. Nobody has to do anything for you. Once God wakes you up, now it's on you. When God wakes you up, he wakes you up on purpose, with purpose. Now, what will you do with this day? That's what the Bible says. This is the day the Lord has made. I will be glad and rejoice in it. Because every day is filled with increase. But will I trust God, or will I whine and complain and blame other folks about my dilemmas and my crises? The devil didn't make you sick. Eating ice cream and chocolate cake every day for 10 years made you sick.
There's a priest this morning.
When you swipe your card and it comes back to Christ, that's not spiritual warfare. You spent all your money. Oh, stop, it didn't matter.
Help us, help us.
Yes, sir.
I pray the minister of music made you shout.
Yeah.
Because I'm trying to shout it out.
Come on, Pastor, you're teaching.
We got power.
Yeah.
But we're not using it.
That's right. Amen.
So use the habit of gun. I have several men here who carry concealed handgun license. They pack guns. Well, what's the use of having a gun with no bullets? How much confidence you gonna have when the brother comes in and your gun is full of blanks? And that's what the church has been doing. Filling our guns up with blanks. So we've lost our confidence. Look at Mark chapter 7. Look at Mark chapter 7. And I'm almost done. Look at Mark chapter 7. I pray you get in this. Mark chapter 7, verse 8, 9, and 13. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions. And Jesus continued, you have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. Verse 13, thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like this. Wow, Jesus checking the church.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Jesus calling the church out. In the 21st century, Jesus will be saying, you dress your kids up on Halloween to go trick-or-treating in the rain, but wouldn't dress them up for church on Sunday because of the rain.
You gotta breathe!
We're going to stand in lines for hours on Black Friday to buy stuff for Christmas, but won't show the honor of Jesus on Good Friday. Before you get the news, I'm not converting to a Muslim.
Amen.
But I am boycotting Christmas. The Christmas you've been serving that have eliminated Jesus Christ from it. I don't want to have anything to do with that foolishness another day of my life. I'm not promoting a Santa Claus, nor a tree, nor a reindeer. If it's not Jesus, it's not of Jesus. Because see, many of you will put a great deal of emphasis on Santa Claus and happy holidays and never celebrate whose birthday it really is. I would be highly upset if a bunch of Negroes came to my house on my birthday and asked me what did I have for them. Can you be real for a minute?
Yeah.
On your next birthday, I'm going to throw a party at your house, and I'm going to expect you to have gifts for me when I show up. You wouldn't like that too much. Well, how do you think our Lord and Savior feels now in America, where from Black Friday to Christmas Eve, we spend all our money, all our time, we plan all kind of Christmas parties, and we're doing all this stuff, but never include the one who should be honored. And you wonder, remember Jesus said, God said, because you have rejected my word, I'm now going to reject your children. Ooh, you're not getting this. It's hard enough in America. But when God steps back and let the children have their own mind.
Come on, man of God.
Jesus.
Jesus responds to their doubt in Mark chapter 3 by giving an illustration. Well, family fighting against each other all the time.
All right.
Man, can you imagine? Every day. somebody in the family at war with one another. Jesus says, in this case, no one the devil. When we wake the heaven up and realize we are better and stronger together. Grab your neighbor by the hand and squeeze it real tight. And declare, I need you.
I need you.
And you need me.
And you need me.
Together.
Together.
We're better.
We're better.
Now celebrate the person whose hand you're holding. Celebrate. So Jesus posed this question to the doubters. Is it possible to walk into a strong man's house and walk away with his stuff? Can you imagine? Stand up, brothers. All the brothers in the house, stand up, stand up, brothers, stand up. Okay. Oh, I love you. There. I like that cross you're wearing. I like that. So, give me your address.
Help!
Okay, tonight. No, I'm gonna be tonight. I'm mad. I'm gonna come in at about 4 o'clock before it get dark. I'm not gonna knock on the door nor ring the doorbell. I'm gonna kick the door in. And I'm gonna come in while you watch the game. And I'm not gonna snatch it, I don't wanna break it. I'm gonna take your cross off your neck, put it around my neck, and walk out your house and say, it's now my cross. You going for that?
All right.
Well, he said he's not going for it. Yet the devil has come in and stolen our stuff with no real resistance. Yet we will fight for our neckness. We will fight for our big screen TV. Oh, you better not mess with my PlayStation. We will fight for our stuff. But we will let the devil take our family.
Come on,
man. You see it?
Come on.
Come on.
Come on.
Jesus.
So we will fight back. But just for the wrong stuff. I ain't want nobody to disrespect me. Well, you've been letting the devil disrespect you year after year. The devil has been disrespecting the men in your family from generation to generation. When you going to start fighting the real enemy back? You can huff and puff at your children and the women in your family, but when you going to really fight back? When you going to grab your family by the hand and start praying and covering your family with the word of God? When you going to really lead your family? Are you going to be like Adam, silent on the sideline, blaming God? God, if you wouldn't have gave me this wife, then when he gave you a wife, he thought you had the weapons to take care of that wife.
Preach, man of God.
God had no clue that he would give you responsibilities of a family and you would wimp out. You forgot to wake up after the surgery. Before the surgery, Adam was naming and claiming. You dog, you cat, you horse. God put him to sleep and gave him a dream girl. But he stayed asleep. So the enemy was able to come in and take Adam's stuff. Let's break down what Jesus was saying and then let's apply it to our lives on our way out. I see a few things in Jesus' challenge. He says, first of all, he says, in broad daylight. You can see, in broad daylight. Jesus is saying it's time to turn the lights on and come out of the darkness. Yeah. It's time we start living in broad daylight.
Come on.
Let your light so shine.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, God. How many of you grew up in the inner city? And, you know, I know now you don't live there anymore, but when you would flip the lights on first thing in the morning, a bunch of little critters would... In the dark. They didn't have the boldness to run around when the lights were on. But then they start realizing we really didn't have much power. So they became bold enough to come out in the day. See, it used could be a time where the freaks only came out at night.
You better preach!
Now they're bold to walk around in broad daylight.
You better preach!
Right in your face.
Come on, yeah.
You don't believe me? Go to Walmart on West Road.
Yeah! Yeah!
Yeah. Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Broad daylight. He's talking about the enemy now is so bold and aggressive that it does not have to wait tonight. I told a young man, I'm not going to come at your house at night. I'm so bold, I'm going to come get it in broad daylight, because that's what the enemy is right now. The enemy's mindset is that we're so watered down as believers. We say we people of faith and we have no faith. We're saying we're Christians, but we're not Christ-like. Do you know Christ said the righteous shall take it by force? Jesus wasn't no wimp. Jesus wasn't sitting around whining and complaining. When Jesus didn't like the way they were treating his father's house, he went in and turned everything over and dared anybody to step up to the plate. Jesus wasn't no sissy. He walked through an angry mob. They said, when Jesus get here, we're going to throw him over the cliff. Jesus walked right through him. I'm waiting. For 40 days, Goliath stood the battle line, tell the children of Israel, I dare you, I double dog dare you to come and fight me. For 40 days, he showed up and said, I dare you, I dare you. But then on the 41st day, young David showed him, who is that uncircumcised Philistine? I dare you, this my God. I dare you, this my family. I dare you, this my legacy. David says, I'm going to step to you because you coming in sword and dagger, but I'm coming in the name of the Lord Almighty. I wish I had some soldiers in here that would step to the devil and say, what I have, I can't lose.
I'm in sword and dagger.
In broad daylight, Goliath was calling them out. Then Jesus says, wake up. He says, wake up. Jesus tells us it's time to wake up and stop dreaming. Wake up.
Wake up.
My God.
Spike Lee didn't know how prophetic he was in the movie, Do the Right Thing. At the end of the movie, the alarm went off and he was screaming, wake up. And that's how I feel like today to the church. Wake up! When I go through the hood, wake up! When I'm having to counsel all these mothers who are losing their children to senseless murder and nobody is caring, when are we going to start caring about what's going on in our own community? I'm not hating on the third world nations. I'm not hating on protecting the borders. But when anybody going to protect my borders in Greensport and Fieldwood and Angels Hall and Sunnyside and City Gas? When anybody going to give a hoot about the young boy on the street corner and the young girl who's lost her way? When are we going to fight for the inner cities of America? Stop electing people that only show up in election season. Wake up! Giving your time, talent, treasure to a preacher that won't show up when there's a tragedy. Wake up.
Wake up.
That's good.
Wow.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
He says, wake up.
Wake up.
Brother, stand back up again.
My God.
Now, Blue. I don't know you. You don't know me. But I'm awoke.
My God.
I don't know your story.
My God.
But I'm awoke enough to know you need God.
Yes.
And God loves you in spite of anything you've been through. And you're not here by coincidence. You're here because God wanted me to let you know he loves you. And I love you too. It ain't nothing funny or shaky. I woke it up and I desire to save you and your crew.
Amen, amen.
time to wake up.
Wake up, fuck God.
Wake up and be the church.
Yeah.
Not play church.
No.
Not entertain one another.
Come on.
Makes me sick. How I know church closed. The devil is a liar.
Come on, man of God.
Yeah.
Get your soul here.
Wake up, church.
Wake up.
Wake up, church.
And then Jesus says, not only do we deal with broad daylight and we got to wake up, but he says, because you don't sleep during the broad daylight. Which is able, get this description, able bodies. Jesus commanding us to man up, to woman up, and perform like we're able to win.
Like we are winners. Jesus, this morning.
I'm amazed that whenever a player gets on the roster of the New England Patriots, it's like he has a transformation. And because he's in a winning locker room with a winning coach and a winning quarterback, his whole arrogance and swag, his whole sports DNA changes. Randy Moss was counted out, was getting ready to be kicked out the league, and they shipped him over to the New England Patriots, and a guy that was dogging on the field got in the New England Patriots locker room and broke all kind of records when everybody else said he was done, because in that atmosphere, it did something to him. It's about a winning atmosphere that will change your mind. It's about a winning, if your marriage in trouble, stop hanging around a bunch of broke folks in their marriage. If your money is funny, stop running around with a bunch of shopaholics.
You gotta change. You gotta change.
Listen to me. Wake up. Change will not happen until you are bold enough to actually change. Talking about change, preaching about change, singing about change will not cause change until you actually operate and step into the arena of change. Change the doggone atmosphere. He calls you able-bodied. You're not like the man at the pool waiting for somebody to put you in. If you ain't able to stand up, I dare about 50 of you to stand on your feet right now. If you're able body, stand up. If you're able to stand, that means you're able to walk. If you're able to walk, you're able to walk by faith. If you're able to walk by faith, you understand that God says, if you walk by faith, I'll walk with you.
Glory to God this morning.
Hallelujah.
You gotta shift your.
I was so blessed this morning by a phone call we received. A young lady on the way to a college tour who has every reason to lay down and fail, every reason to haul her body out, every reason to be retarded in her mind. She's from a jacked up situation, but somehow she just believes, in spite of what I see on the daily, if I keep walking by faith, God's going to walk me out this environment, and God's going to do something in my life to bless my sister's life and bless my mama's life and change this generational curse off of me. I'm telling you, no matter what you've been through, I can find somebody who walked by faith and mourned with the broken hand you were dealt. That little handicapped boy jumping down, praising God, a high school degree, on his way to college, working, doing well, when everybody counted him out, but he kept saying, glory. And you well able, you still sitting down on your butt whining and complaining, but your mama wasn't there, and your daddy wasn't there. The hell with that. Instead, she decided to turn her drama into a story. and you can't get over it. Some joker told you you were too fat and he didn't love you anymore, and now you sitting at home watching Lifetime eating a gallon of ice cream every night, proving him right. Get off! Get in the gym, get on the track, do something to show him you got your sexy back, but you don't want him back.
Jesus.
I had a confrontation with a TV anchor this week. I said, I'm not afraid of you going writing a bad story. Been that, done that. You got to do something better than that. He was saying that there's nobody making enough noise about the kid in Chicago. And I'm saying, well, why are you not making enough noise with your position at Channel 11 about the kid in Acres Home, about the kid in 31? I didn't see you and your camera show up when those kids was murdered down the street. I didn't see you showing in. Don't act like you super conscious now because the national story. If you won't talk about Lil Baby and Lil Ray Ray in your own city, you better shut up before I get on you. Watch this. I gotta go. But he says, take your towel, man. Take it off. Take your towel. Come here, corner. Watch this. Come on. But bring towel with you. Wait. Get, both of y'all come quickly. Come on. Wait, yeah, watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Your imagination, your daughter's back at home. Little back at home. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Raise your hand. Pookie decides he's gonna come snatch your daughters. You in the military, you gotta use all the weapons in your cabinet. Watch this. And you can stop Pookie from taking your daughters as long as you able body. Okay. And you are a monk, yeah. Unless.
Oh,
come here, Pookie. See, Pookie come. And Pookie ain't got a line because Pookie know now you tied up. Pookie, take it. Boy, why?
Still
able,
go ahead.
Your dog wasn't talking about me. Pookie. You still. You gotta watch y'all. We gonna clean up, Pookie. Hey, go, Pookie. Don't forget my cut now. Hold on, where's again? Says now the enemy Drake can come in and kill, steal, and destroy. Take your family, take your faith, take your fitness, take your finances, and take your future. And ain't nothing you can do about it because now you're tied up. When you're high, you're tied up. When you're mad, you're tied up. When you're unemployed and you're a grown butt man sitting at home playing PlayStation while your woman at work trying to make ends meet, you tied up. When you whiner and complainer, you tied up. When you blaming your mama and them, and you 30-something years old, you tied up. When your mind ain't right, you tied up. So now the enemy comes in and takes all your stuff. Let's roll, Pookie. And the only thing you can do is hope. Somebody. Can save you and rescue you. Stop right here. But let me close with this. When this happened to David at Ziklag, when David and the army got back to Ziklag, and the enemy had came in and took all David's stuff, took David's wife, took David's boy's wife, took David's children, took David's boy's children, took all David's stuff. David was right here. He could have gave up. And then, come here, Hesbeth. And then the boys that was rolling with David, the couple say that it's his fault. If he wouldn't have brought us out here, we wouldn't have lost our stuff. Yes. So now your boys against you. The enemy got your stuff. Everybody will understand and justify if you gave up right now. But David says, I can't quit right now. And David started to untie himself. David started to call on the name of the Lord. And David says, God, I need you to tell me, should I go after my stuff? Will you empower me to go back and get my stuff? God, will you give me the strength to keep on going when I feel like giving up? David fell down on his knees, and the men around him thought he was getting ready to break down and give up. What they didn't understand was the life knocked David down. David didn't fall down, but David went down, because David realized just a little talk with Jesus would make it all right. David realized, before I move forward, before I bust a move, I gotta make sure I've heard from heaven. So when David got word from heaven, heaven said, David, go get your stuff. Get up. Stop complaining. Stop whining. And don't worry about who's gonna go with you. You just walk by faith. The Bible says, and David's gonna walk it out of Ziklag, a place of destruction, a place of defeat, a place of disaster. And David made his mind up. I'm going to find Bukie. And I don't care who go with me. I'm going to find Bukie. And when I get to Bukie, I'm going to take back everything the devil has stolen from me. David says, I woke the heaven up, and I'm not going to go out like this. I got too much God in me. The same God that took out Goliath, the same God that took me from there and got me here, the same God when a lion came, the same God when a bear came, the same God when Saul tried to take me out, the same God. Is there anybody here that you got a story of how the Lord brought you over? Anybody here? You didn't need Drake to tell you that God can bring you from the bottom to the top. Is there anybody here? And God bless you back to back. Is there anybody here? And you got more haters than a little bit, but your haters didn't stop you. You got both been telling you what you can't do and what you can't become. But that was a little word, I can. Do I have anybody here with an I can spirit? I see a little girl from Spring High School that went to UT and dominated academically. Now she travels the world bossing with her Gucci and her Louis, and she still got money in her bank. The devil said she couldn't, but God said I can. High five your neighbor and say, I see the best in you. So David got the bouquet, and David says, you know what time it is. I'm getting my stuff back. You know what time it is. I've woken up now. Give me back my stuff. Give me back my stuff. And Bukie, you got a choice right now. Either you can roll with me and join the army of the Lord, or the army of the Lord is getting ready to roll over you. That's what you told me to be my demise. What you told would take me out. What the devil meant for bad, God turned it around for my good. So I'm giving you a choice. Either get with me or get rolled over. What's your choice?
I'm going to get with you.
Now, stand up. Now. Because you were in Pookie's army and you see Pookie's admitted. Now you say, I want some of that Jesus too. That's how you win a community. That's how you win a city. You get one Pookie saved. You
you show one family you got the power, and all of a sudden, another family and another family and another family show up. I wish I had somebody that was ready to wake the heaven up and win back your family, win back your neighborhood, win back your community. Enough is enough. Wake the heaven up.
I love you. Come on, forever, forever. Good, I love you. I love you forever, forever.